Last time was too hot, now it's rather cold. Okay. May I start?
Yes.
Okay, so this is a second seminar devoted to fundamental problems in quantum chromodynamics, QCD. from my plans, which I announced several days ago, I managed to tell you about history of quantum chromodynamics and its mathematical foundations, formulation. Then I describe briefly quantum chromodynamics on the lattice, how it is introduced, how it is quantized. We speak a little bit about strong interactions. And I finish with a list of problems which I'm going to discuss. So we accomplished 1, 2, 3, 4 first items, and today I'm going to speak about problems of QCD. Okay, so I skip all previous materials from last talk and go to new presentation. Actually, I remember we finished exactly on this slide, where I summarize in general words the main three theoretical or theoretical problems of QCD. The first one has to explain why nuclear force is strong but short range. Then we have to, QCD has to explain hadron masses. And finally, the most exciting and probably the most well-known problem of QCD is a problem which is called confinement of quarks. We never see individual quarks. And QCD must explain this. Okay, let me start from the first one. Which is called short-range nature of the strong interactions. We know that quarks inside of hadrons interact very strongly. As it's written here, after a limited distance of the size of hadron has been reached, it remains at a strength of about 10,000 newtons, no matter how much faster the distance between the quarks. And then strong force is much, much weaker between colorless, they also called white objects like neutron and proton. Here, I already told, we don't know exact form of potential, but we know that it decreases very, very fast, probably exponentially fast. How one could explain this property of strong interactions? The main conjecture is that quantum chromodynamics has a mass gap. At the classical level, gluons are massless, but in reality, this gauge fields cannot exist as scalar states. They are confined and form bound states, which are called glue balls. Glue balls are massive composite particles. So it's supposed that hadrons cannot interact via exchange of massless gluons, but only via massive glue balls and light mesons. Moreover, we know that if glue balls do exist, they are so massive that probably the main interactions between hadrons are due to exchange of light mesons. Before going further, well, let me say a few words informally. From I theological, let me say, like this point of view, this problem of generating mass gap is the most difficult for people who know quantum field theory but don't know many details of quantum chromodynamics. And the main objection is, how is it possible? We have massless gluons at the classical level. How it happens that in quantum theory there is no massless excitations, but only we have a mass gap. And this objection arises after so many numerical Monte Carlo simulations, which clearly demonstrate that there is mass gap. Moreover, it's already 21 years as the famous Millennium Problem was formulated, and which asks for proving a rigorous mathematical proving of this mass gap existence. Still, many people do not believe or do not understand why it's so. Because of complexity of this problem, let me start from a very simple example. Very simple example of two-dimensional gauge model. In two dimensions, you have approximately the same picture. On the classical level, we have massless gauge fields, massless gluons. Lagrangian is pretty much the same. But essential difference for four-dimensional model is that we can solve this model exactly. Of course, I'm not going to say how we can do this. I only show the final result and explain. Okay, so you start from lattice regularization of two-dimensional Young-Mills model. Here, action is Wilson action, which I showed you last time. Okay, we can exactly perform all integration over gauge field configurations and come to this expression for partition function. This expressed as sum over lambda, which describe eigenstates. E2 minus m lambda of g are eigenvalues of transfer matrix, which can be constructed for two dimensions. And d lambda is nothing but the generation of lambda level. Because this E2 minus M are eigenvalues, then M lambda, it depends on original coupling constant, of course, is nothing but mass gap. This expression clearly shows that we started from massless Lagrangian, but theory does not have massless excitations. We have only massive spectrum. Near continuum limit, when a coupling constant goes to zero, this mass gap is given exactly by this simple formula. N number of colors, G coupling constant, and C2 of lambda is eigenvalues of quadratic Casimir operator. And what is also important is that theory is asymptotically free, similar to four-dimensional case. This asymptotic freedom follows from this formula number seven. So you see, we have all this feature which we can find in four dimensions. Classical theory is massless. In quantum theory, we have asymptotic freedom. Nevertheless, spectrum of the theory is discrete. Okay, so we have example of such model, which gives some non-trivial mass gap in quantum theory.
Excuse me. in the continuum limit, it goes to zero and also mass gap goes to zero.
No, it's not.
Why isn't the continuum limit g equal to zero? That's the question 7. G equals lambda limit a equal to, goes to zero means.
No, it stays constant. You adjust in proper way. It depends on scale lambda, which you, if you can compare these predictions, theoretical predictions with experiment, you could extract this parameter lambda and everything is expressed in terms of this
yes, yes. I see the
parameter lambda.
Lambda is n should be as it is written now in equation 6, it is a dimensionless.
Yes.
There must be that should be g over a squared. So, because g is dimensionless, but n is not dimensionless. So there should be something which gives them.
This is in lattice units, of course.
Okay.
In some sense, two-dimensional model is trivial. We can easily construct this exact solution. Much more non-trivial example was provided by Polyakov in 77. And many people know that in one of his papers, he proved confinement of electrons in three-dimensional compact U1 gauge model. In the same paper, he also proved that photons in this three-dimensional gauge theory are massive. A rigorous proof of these two statements were given just 5 years later by Gottlieb and Mach. Three-dimensional model is already very, very non-trivial. Nevertheless, we also have a proof that we start from a theory where photon masses are zero on the level of classical Lagrangian, but in quantum theory, something happens and generates mass gap. And photons become massive in this model. Nice feature is that in this particular case, we know mechanism which provides confinement of electrons and also give a mass gap through photons. This contribution from so-called topological configurations, which are called monopoles in this case. This upper bound, lower bound on mass gap, as was proven by Gilford and Mach. Of course, an important question which arises from this two-dimensional example and from this three-dimensional example is how generation of this mass gap agrees with perturbative expansion, which relies on the existence of continuous spectrum and masses. Gauge fields. In general, it's very non-trivial question. Maybe I don't know the very good physical explanation why perturbation theory works in this case. But mathematical answer is well known. It consists in statements that perturbation theory is expansion in powers of coupling constant. Mass gap in 3 and 4 dimension is exponentially small in coupling constant. So it behaves like exponent minus 1 over g So perturbation theory simply cannot fill such small mass gap. Small in terms, of course, of Baire-Carlton concept. Okay, now after this two examples, let's go back to four-dimensional theory. In QCD, of course, we cannot construct exact solution. Moreover, we cannot even make estimates like it was done for three-dimensional U1 model. So we have to rely on some analytical approximations or numerical Monte Carlo simulations. Methods in quantum chromodynamics are extracted from certain correlation functions to compute global masses. The most popular such operator is expectation value of product of two plaquettes on some distance, say, on some large distance. I remind you that trace plaquettes in continuum formulation means strength, Young-Mills strength tensor. And we need, of course, so-called connected part of this correlation function. If at large distances such correlation decreases exponentially, it means that mass gap is really generated in the theory. For example, if you compute this correlation in four-dimensional U1 model, you would find a column-like behavior for this correlation. And that means that in ordinary electrodynamics, there is no mass gap. But in QCD, we really see this mass gap. Okay, so as I told, we can extract this mass gap either analytically in some approximations. This can be done, for example, in the strong coupling expansion. And to leading order in this strong coupling expansion, the mass is given by this formula up to this corrections. And I think this corrections are known to very high order. Unfortunately, strong coupling expansion is convergent, but it has a finite radius of convergence, and we cannot construct continuum limit from this expansion. So to extract some good quantities, we should rely on Monte Carlo simulations of this and similar expectation values. And what I quote here are results, maybe not the very last, but they obtained a few years ago, results for some lightest global masses. Of course, maybe you know this story about experimental search for global states. I think people try to find such massive global states for few decades already. There are a few candidates, but as far as I understand the situation, nobody is sure that these are really states which deserve to be called gluons. So we know that there are masses, but there are certain difficulties in locating precisely the states in experiment. Okay, this is a general situation about mass gap in globals in QCD. This problem of mass gap generation was expressed in this famous Millennium problem. It was formulated by Arthur Jaffe and Edward Witten in 21 years ago. And it sounds exactly like it's written here. Prove that for any compact single gauge group G, an untrivial quantum Young-Mills theory exists on R4 and has a mass gap delta larger than zero. In general, this Millennium problem consists of two parts. The first one is we have to prove that Young-Mills theory exists in some rigorous mathematical sense. Second part is more physical and requires the proving that this mass gap exists. Several years later, in 2009, Edward Witten wrote a very nice semi-popular paper about this mass gap. Should take this in quotation mark. Let me just read it. This mass gap is one of the most basic things that made the universe the way it is. The mass gap is the reason that we do not see classical non-linear Young-Mills waves, similar to waves in quantum electrodynamics. I have spent most of my career wishing that we had a really good way to quantitatively understand the mass gap in four-dimensional gauge theory. I hope that this problem will be solved one day. I finish this part, again, stating what one has to prove. On the latter side, we have a rigorous formulation of this problem. Yes. We have to compute this expectation value of lattice strength tensor and prove that it decays exponentially like e to minus delta r, where r is distance between two plaquettes. This first point and second point, of course, this is lattices. Then we have to prove that non-trivial continuum limit of this expectation value exists. As usually, mass gap is defined as a difference between vacuum energy and energy of first excited state. Okay, so you can try. Well, I'm done this first problem about mass gap. Maybe before to go to next problem, if you have some question, maybe it's better if I answer now.
What happened to the Tombouli's attempt? Tombouli's many years ago presented a claim that he had found the proof of this in a simple.
First of all, his claim was that he found the proof of confinement, not mass gap, confinement. Second, his paper was never published because there were many comments in Heplat on his proof. And my personal view is that his proof is not correct. Of course, I was not referee of this paper. It was mathematical, I would say. But I know who was referee. Okay, then let's go to next problem. This is about explanation of hadron masses, or equivalently about mass of visible matter in the universe. QCD must explain hadron masses. Usually it's not a problem, as the mass of some ordinary body equals the sum of its constituents. Probably up to small corrections, as is the case in atomic nucleus. QCD completely violates this rule. The quarks that make up the proton are only about 1% of the proton's actual mass. You see, the numbers are written here, approximate numbers. So the question is, where this difference comes from? And because we know that approximately 99% of the mass of visible matter in the universe is due to protons and neutrons, this problem is often formulated as a problem of explanation of mass of visible matter in the universe. Okay, to go into this explanation, we should come back to some symmetry properties of QCD Lagrangian, which I listed in first part of my talk. Now I remind you that QCD Lagrangian is invariant under so-called chiral transformations of quark fields. More precisely, it means the following. QCD Lagrangian has the following symmetry, direct product of two U and F groups. This direct product can be decomposed into two SUN times two U1. And chiral rotations act on left-handed and right-handed fermions, as it's written here. This 1 plus minus Hammett 5 over 2 is projection operators, of course. And these chiral rotations leave kinetic part of QCD Lagrangian invariant. The mass term, if it's present in Lagrangian, of course it is present. Mass term breaks the symmetry explicitly. However, often we consider masses of UD and sometimes even as strange quarks as very small. So this explicit breaking can be neglected in the first approximation in the theory with two or even three lightest flavors. Then, the main conjecture is that QCD has a spontaneous chiral symmetry breaking, and masses appears due to this spontaneous breaking of the following pattern. This direct product is broken to one SUN. We know very well what is order parameter of this spontaneous symmetry breaking. This order parameter is called quark condensate, and its definition is written here. This expectation value of sum over all colors, psi bar A times psi A. there are many attempts to explain what happens in QCD on many much, much simpler examples. I think that one of the most popular attempts to explain what's going on in QCD is an analogy with magnetization in two-dimensional Eisen model in external magnetic field. So on this axis, we have this magnetization, and here we have external magnetic field, some dimensionless unit. When external field is absent, is a model has some global symmetry. At higher temperatures, the symmetry is unbroken, but when temperature is lower, you can reach a point where a system undergoes second order phase transition. At this point, this global symmetry of its model is spontaneously broken. And above, below this critical temperature, non-zero magnetization appears. When we add external magnetic field H to the system, this magnetic field explicitly breaks the global symmetry. Nevertheless, let's have a look what's going on with magnetization in the presence of this magnetic field. Here you can see three different plots for this magnetization. Below, at critical point, and above critical point. So this triangles. This is above critical beta, this is at critical beta and below critical beta. We can make, looking at this plot, we can make a simple conclusion that when violation of global symmetry due to external field is weak, so H is very small, the main value of magnetization comes from spontaneous breaking of this global symmetry. Already for very small H, magnetization reaches its highest or largest possible value, plus or minus one, much above critical point. This is what we assume happens in quantum chromodynamics. Despite small explicit breaking of chiral symmetry, the most masses in QCD appears due to this spontaneous breaking of chiral transformations. Again, not quantitatively, but qualitatively, it describes in the following words. Consider a theory with two flavors. Then quark condensate can be formally presented as a vector. U bar U, V bar D, U bar D, D bar U. At each point in space, the vacuum can be described by this vector that can, in principle, point in any direction in this four-dimensional space. This axis labeled like it's written here. In the state with lowest energy, QCD predicts that all these vectors must be aligned. They must point in one direction. And this causes spontaneous symmetry breaking. Then, if we add quarks to this QCD vacuum where we have this condensate, these quarks interact with this condensate. And the result is that they behave as if they have a large mass. And the largest contribution to the mass of the hadron comes from the interaction energy between quarks hadron is made of, and this condensate. Of course, this is very qualitative picture. Can we make it more precise somehow? Again, like in the previous case with mass gap, we can do some analytical computations in the strong coupling regime. And to make some, to extract some real hadron quantities, calculate quark condensate near continuum limit, again, we should rely on Monte Carlo simulations. In the strong coupling region, we can start from, again, from lattice regularization of QCD. And in this strong coupling region, when beta goes to zero, it's possible to, again, integrate out exactly all gauge, gauge field configurations and construct what is called effective theory for composite mesons and baryons. The first such attempts were done in the end of 80s, so pretty long ago. This story is developing. You know already some, not some, many corrections to this leading order behavior. Nevertheless, it remains in the region of strong power. Well, when computed in this region from effective theory for meson and baryons, we can compute both quark condensate sigma, and we can extract baryon masses from baryon correlation function. Yeah, so it's possible to do analytically, but I'm not ready to answer the question, how reliable are these masses, and if they can be compared with masses extracted from Monte Carlo simulations. I don't know. Okay, so again, to compute for condensate and most importantly, directly hadron masses, we have to go to Monte Carlo simulation. Such hadron masses are computed again from certain correlation functions of the form written here. These operators O are constructed from, of course, from quark fields in such a way that these operators have the same quantum numbers as hadrons, mass of which we want to calculate. Of course, this operator, which as if corresponds to some hadron, is a local operator. In reality, it's not like this. We know that proton is not a local object, for example. Proton is not a local object. Nevertheless, because it has the same quantum numbers, it has some non-zero overlap with vacuum of this a state described by hadron, by, for example, by proton, and then thanks to universality, one can expect that correlation of such operators should behave as an exact hadron correlation function near continuum point. Okay, example of such correlation is written here. And well, I think since the end of 80s or beginning of 90s, there were many, many attempts to compute this hadron masses from numerical simulations. And real breakthrough in this computation was done in 2009 by Lattice, Budapest, Marcel, Wuppertal group. They simulated QCD with dynamical quarks. Their computations took few years on big supercomputers, including Blue-Gene. Okay, and when they published their results, everyone understood that this is a real breakthrough in computation of hadron masses. They computed, as you see, a lot of masses of different hadrons with three input parameters. They needed to fix masses of up, down, and stretch quarks, and to fix this masses as input, they took three masses of pi, k, and this meson. From this input, they extracted masses of up, down, and s quark, and then from first principle, they compute the masses of rest particles. And as you see, coincidence is very, very good. Of course, since 2009, a lot of further progress was made. These computations are permanently improving. More particles are added. Okay, so the story continues. And finishing this part, I would like to mention recent work, I mean, not so recent, 3 years ago. This group also computed hadron masses for zero initial values of quarks. And the result was really interesting. So it's written here. If the up, down, and stretch quark masses were all zero, the proton would still have more than 90% of its experimental mass. This is due to interaction between quarks inside of hadrons with quark condensate, which appears in the QCD.
Sorry, before going on, I'm a bit lost. As far as I understand, the dynamical symmetry group breaking, so the four points, is a mechanism that could, in a sense, justify the presence of mass gap. Okay, and indeed, as far as I remember, in a lattice simulation where you have quarks, chiral symmetry breaking, and say, doesn't have confined. They are very, very close. But in the absence of quarks, I don't see how you can have this mechanism. So, as far as I understand it, the quark condensate is not required strictly to have a mass gap, right? But at a certain point, I saw that you wrote, then we add the quarks to the QCD. In a sense, implying that you already have a condensate, and then you add other quarks. Is it correct, or I misunderstood? Maybe I misunderstood.
Not sure I understood the question. The mass gap itself you're speaking about. What is this mass gap? When I spoke about mass gap, we considered only pure gauge theory without quarks. Then I started to explain hadron masses. It's a different story. It's not a mass gap.
So for mass gap you mean Q, and then so you don't need the quark to create a mass gap, right?
To explain gluon masses, or more precisely global masses, I don't need quarks.
Okay. So probably I misunderstood the one slide. Okay. he's gone. Maybe I will ask you later.
This one?
Yeah, exactly. Apparently, there you have the you see, vacuum is a complicated mixture of condensates.
And yes, if QCD vacuum.
To the QCD vacuum. What do you mean? You already have, if I understand correctly, the first three lines. I'm wrong?
Sorry, what I have?
No, okay. You have these first three lines. QCD vacuum is a complicated mixture of condensate. U bar U, D bar D, so you already have works.
No. I'm speaking about QCD vacuum. QCD vacuum is very complicated structure, which is formed from many condensates. One of these condensates is quark condensate. This is certain expectation value,
yes,
in our.
But then, what
terminology
do you add later on? Then you add the quarks to your QCD vacuum, but you already have, some condensate. So I would be tempted to conclude that you must already have some quark. No?
QCD is described by this expression.
Just gauge field.
We have gauge fields and we have this contribution.
Okay.
This is contribution from so called sear quarks. If you want to understand the masses of structure of protons, we have to compute certain expectation values. That is precisely what is behind my words. If we add quarks to QCD vacuum, all this, including CR quarks, are vacuum. Condensate comes from this contribution from quarks. Then we add external quarks to describe hadrons.
You have
said, is it what you asked?
Perhaps I got it. So, thank you.
Okay. The last point of my talk is devoted to confinement problem. First of all, one has to say that mass gap generation in QCD is not a unique phenomenon. We can find a similar phenomena in a variety of different systems, ranging from classical spin models to many other quantum field theories. Also, spontaneous breaking of the symmetry takes place in a number of models. The simplest example I mentioned already is spontaneous magnetization in Eason model. So these two features of QCD are not unique. What is really unique in QCD is the absence of fundamental particles, quarks, in the spectrum of the cell. Nothing similar we can find in any other model. QCD must explain why we cannot see quarks. Well, so it was conjectured that there is a permanent confinement of quarks, so that these elementary particles cannot be observed in principle. And this phenomena is a distinguished feature of QCD. Despite reading many historical reviews on QCD-related models, I could not find who is author of this conjecture. Obviously, it's not Wilson, because Wilson, in his paper where he introduced what's now called order parameter of confinement, he already refers in his 74 paper to confinement as some common knowledge. That's an interesting fact. Okay. Are we sure that there is no quarks in the spectrum of the floor? There is a very long story for searching of fractional electric charges. As I showed you, and you know this for sure, quarks carry fractional electric charges. And attempts to find such fractional electric charges have been made from beginning of sequence. This is a group from SLEC, which published not annually, but maybe one review in several years, where they explain their searches of this fractional charge. And okay, this is taken from their review of 2009. The statement is that this possibility has not been realized. So, no one so far has seen the states with fractional electrical charge. It's just to show that conjecture about confinement has a good experimental background. Because first of all, one has to explain what is confinement. The problem is that in many popular reviews, even in many theoretical papers, people refer to confinement in rather incorrect, in false way. It's not so trivial to formulate confinement problem in some rigorous frameworks. Nevertheless, it was done. Now we know how to formulate this. But many misleading statements still are present, even in professional literature. It's already a long story to explain all these incorrect statements. Some of them are written here. So what is confinement? Could there be the absence of free particles with fractional electric charge? In general, no, because quark can form some bound state with massive scalar, transforming in the same fundamental representation of color as nu. So, the very popular explanation of what is confinement relies on statements that in gauge theory, if we integrate out gauge fields, we end up with composite meson and baryons. No separate quarks will be found in such after such an integration. Again, this is false statement because the same you can do in four-dimensional U1 theory and end up with theory for mesons constructed from electron or positron theory. And finally, the most popular statement about confinement is that confinement means absence of free particles with non-vanishing color charge. And this definition is not correct. It confuses confinement with color screening, as it happens, for example, in SU3 gauge Higgs theory in the massive phase. Moreover, as we know now, and as I will explain in few slides, QCD, as it is formulated, cannot confine all color charges. It can confine only certain color charges. here it's written that I'm not going to discuss confinement in the theory with dynamical quarks in fundamental representation. It's closely related but slightly different topic, and also I'm not going to discuss mechanism of confinement. It deserves a different seminar. I only mention this points shortly. Okay, to formulate confinement problem, again, let's look at the symmetry of QCD Lagrangian listed before. I already remind you about chiral symmetry. Now I remind you about so-called center symmetry. QCD Lagrangian is invariant under global center transformations. These transformations are composed of center elements of Hessian group written here. They are distinguished because all center elements of SUN commute with all other elements of this group. These are the only transformations under which gauge fields are identically invariant, but quark fields in fundamental representation transform like it's written here in standard way, like under any gauge transformation. Okay, so if quark field is taken in a representation trivial on the center subgroup, then it is invariant under certain center transformation. According to these rules, the number and ality, it is called triality in QCD, is assigned to gauge and quark fields. So gauge fields are invariant, so they have an ality zero. Quarks carry a unit of an ality charge. Antiquark have an ality minus. An ality is multiplicative number as follows from this transformation. So it is defined up to module n. So in QCD, n equals zero is equivalent to n 3, 6, 9, and so on. Well, all patterns which we observe in experiment have vanishing and out. Mesons are composed from quark antiquark, so plus one plus minus one is zero. Baryons are composed of three quarks, so triality three, which is equivalent to zero. If you know about this notion of triality, the confinement problem is formulated in the following way. It was done in the end of 70s by Tuft and Gerard Mach. starting from some non-perturbated regularization of QCD like lattice regularization, construct a proof that all physical states predicted by QCD have vanishing reality. Or in other words, one has to prove that all asymptotic states with non-vanishing reality cannot exist. Okay, still, these are some words, and we have to translate now these words into some mathematical equations to really understand what we have to prove. Kenneth Wilson was the first who proposed such method. Ideologically, it's very simple. It relies on well-known procedure. Let's take some color charges and insert it in a gauge vacuum. And then let's look on response of this vacuum to this external perturbation. Using this method, depending of what we really inserted in this QCD vacuum, we can write down some order parameters of confinement. The first such order parameter was introduced by Wilson himself in 1974, and it is famous Wilson loop. This Wilson loop measures potential between quark-antiquark pair or potential between three quarks. So this is meson potential, this is baryon potential. Several years later, Polakov introduced so observable, which is now called Polakov. It does the same job as Wilson loop does, but in the final temperature. And this order parameter is not invariant on the center transformations. So when expectation value of this Polakov loop operator is vanishing, it means that we are in confinement. If this order parameter is different from zero, we say that the 10 global symmetry is spontaneously broken. And free quarks can appear in this pattern. And 1 year later, Tuft introduced so-called Tuft loop. Now it's called, oftenly called Tuft loop. This order parameter measures free energy of some topologically non-trivial configurations. There are a few different realizations of this Tuft loop. It can measure free energy of magnetic monopoles, or free energy of magnetic vortices, depends on exact form of this Tuft loop operator, and also it depends on dimension. In reality, as we know now, Wilson and Tuft loops give complete characteristics of all possible phases of gauge models. Altogether, we have gauge model can be in four different phases according to behavior of Wilson and Tuft loop. The simplest and most popular order parameter is the Wilson loop. As name tells, this is a loop, as it's shown on this figure. And to extract potential between static or antiquark pair, it's sufficient to take planar Wilson. In general expectation, value of this Wilson loop directly related to potential between quark and quark pair in the following way. So the loop itself is defined as is written here. This is trace of ordered product of links along the loop C. This is the loop, it's constructed of lattice links. On each link we have a gauge field and product over the links from this loop. And this expectation value is nothing but exponent to minus t v q q bar, where this v is quark potential between quark and antiquark. Then confinement problem reduces to the following. One has to prove that the string tension between static quark antiquark pair is non-vanishing at all values of the Barrett Cauchy bit. And second point, one has to prove that continuum limit of sigma exists. The definition of string tension, one of the most important quantities in QCD, definition is written here. When we take area of loop C to infinity, string tension is defined as 1 over area of this loop times logarithm of this expectation value. From here, follows famous criterion of confinement. If Wilson loop decays with area law, so S area of loop C, then string tension will be non-zero. Usually one takes some rest angular loop of the size R times T, and then as follows from this formula, the potential will take a linear form where I have product of string tension times R, distance between static or antiquark pair. Okay, so to prove confinement, one has to prove area law decay of the Wilson. Now, of course, we have to take R to infinity. If Wilson loop obeys area law, the potential grows linearly with distance, and antiquark cannot be removed to infinity. And so state with non-zero triality cannot exist. You cannot remove quark to on infinite distance. A similar order parameter we can introduce also for baryon potential. It's often called baryonic or Wilson loop or book observable. It looks like a book and consists of three quarks propagating in time direction and annihilating in some point y. Again, we have a product of gauge link matrices around this loop. There are two possible candidates for potential between three quarks. The first candidate is this so-called delta law. And it states that 3Q potential is a sum of two body linear potentials between each pair. This delta is written here. This also confining potential, of course. And second is so-called Y law. In case of white glow, quark potential is a genuine three body potential. Equation is written here, where it the zero is so called Fermi-Torricelli point. It's the point of where the sun between xi is position of three quarks, 1, 2, 3. We take the sun and minimize this. It follows from numerical experiments that string tension is if it's the same in delta law and in y law. It remains, strictly speaking, it remains, still remains a problem which law is realized in the nature, delta or y law. Nevertheless, strong coupling expansion and most recent Monte Carlo simulation support why even we, a few years ago, performed such Monte Carlo simulations in framework of some effective Polakov-Luk model, and we clearly see that why low dominates in this case, in case of three quark potential. Okay, so for quark and t-quark pairs, there is no much choice. We have only linear potential. In case of three quarks, confining potential are either delta or y lows. Y low is preferred. Let me I skip few slides because it's time. Let me summarize behavior of Wilson loop in different presentations. It's important because when I formulated confinement problem, I told that PCD cannot confine all color charges. This is very important. Okay, so we can, in QCD, we can consider quarks not only in fundamental representations, but to understand confinement mechanism deeply, we have to study quarks in many, many representations. The summary of behavior of Wilson loops with different representations is written here. If you take Wilson loops non-trivial on the center, these are, for example, fundamental quarks which really appear in QCD Lagrange. So such Wilson loops at small and intermediate distances always aerial. There are certain diagrams which contribute to such Wilson loops. It's not very important. Wilson loops non-trivial on the center at large distances always again area loop. This only this is physical string tension. Here it's very important fact, and it's not trivial to explain this fact. All Wilson loops decay with the same string tension, which is proportional, equal to fundamental string tension. So everything depends only on the annulity of representation. And very different story is Wilson loops, which are trivial on the center. Trivial, it means they are invariant on the center transformation. The best known example of such quirks are quirks in adjoint representation of the group. Again, at small and intermediate distances, you can observe area law decay. But when you go to physical large distances, Wilson loop always perimeter law decay. And perimeter law, unlike the area law, does not imply confinement. This perimeter law, the corresponding color charges cannot be confined. If there were quarks in adjoint representation in QCD Lagrangian, we would observe such quarks in experiment. That's why the statement QCD cannot confine all color charges. Okay, here are examples of different diagrams contributing to Wilson loop, but okay, let's keep it. And here is behavior of quark-antiquark potential between fundamental quarks. It's a pure gauge model computed by Belli 20 years ago, but it remains it's very important picture demonstrating accuracy of calculations and good coincidence with this famous phenomenological Cornell potential. Cornell potential is written here, and of course the constant G and sigma are fitted from numerical data, and they are written here. This value of string tension of 140 MeV squared turns out to be very close to what people observe in experiment with heavy quarkonium, I think. And qualitative behavior of the same potential in full QCD of this dynamical. According to that, scales in QCD, we can observe three different regions in the behavior of quark-antiquark potential. At small distances, you see asymptotic freedom and Coulomb-like potential. At intermediate distances, up to size of protons, approximately, string tension is, we observe string tension and almost linear potential. And this is a distance of radius of proton. Here we observe phenomena which is called string breaking. To describe this phenomena, we have to consider full theory with dynamical quarks. Here in this table, I summarize behavior of string tension for different abelian and non-abelian models and in different dimensions. Right, I show this table. Okay, let me not comment, but only to stress that if you look carefully at this table, you will see very interesting one. Let's compare confining properties of abelian and non-abelian models. This table shows that despite huge differences between abelian and non-abelian models, when we come to most fundamental problem, most fundamental feature of this models, which is confining, there is no much difference between abelian and non-abelian. The only difference is in four dimensions, where we live. In all other dimensions, properties are the same. For me, it's really fantastic. I cannot explain like this. But because we live in four dimension, we observe this huge difference between abelian and non-abelian models. Otherwise, they are the same. Okay, I also skip this slide with mechanism for confinement, and my last slide show short summary of my talk. Quantum chromodynamics explains the most important features of the strong interactions, namely mass gap generation, masses of hadrons, and confinement. Of course, a number of open questions still exist, and few of them, most important in my view, are listed here. What is Young-Mills spectrum above the mass gap? Edward Witten, whom I cited before, tells that it could be that above this spectrum, we could have continuous spectrum. There is also interesting possibility, but it's still too far to answer this question unambiguously. Then, one of the very popular, okay, maybe not among astrophysicists, but at least among lattice community, is that mass gap in gauge models is n larger than 3 can explain dark matter. Suppose we have pure gauge SU6, for example, pure gauge model, which is in confinement phase. Then in this SUN, SU6 gauge model, we have only global states which are massive. And we know that blue balls are very hard to detect. Moreover, if they don't have any other quantum numbers, they would not interact with any other matter. In some sense, such blue balls would be ideal dark matter. It would be very hard to detect such states, such blue ball states. Of course, mechanism of confinement and mass gap generation is still an open issue. I think it's quite popular to assume that there is one common mechanism underlying mass gap generation and generation of strain tension. A lot of work has been done in this direction and will be done. Hopefully someday such mechanism will be finally discovered and explained. Okay, this delta versus y law I already explained. Another interesting and important issue is relation between confinement and chiral symmetry breaking. Then would be nice to compute analytically some effective Baryon-Mason theory from first principles to see in this equation how we can describe nuclear physics. And finally, full QCD phase diagram at finite temperature and density. Probably this last item is the most popular at the moment. People devoted a lot of efforts to clarify this phase diagram in search for new states of matter, finite temperature and high densities. Okay, I think I stop on this summary.
Further questions or comments?
understand the relation between mass gap in SUM with an algorithm 3 and dark matter? Would that be another SUM? So one should postulate QCD on one side plus some other SUM
yes.
matter around.
Yes.
Well, then this question would be how this.
Alessandro, but there are already many papers about this.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, I can imagine. But how would that? So that matter would be completely decoupled from QCD matter, from standard atomic matter.
Especially if there are no dynamical quarks in that SUN theory, and only gauge matter, then it's completely decoupled.
But then why just SUN and not any other non-Abelian group? One is a group of
because it's the simplest, we know how to work with it. Let's start from this.
Thank you again, Oleg.
Welcome.